Hi friends. So let's discuss another question, Ujipma. And this time a lot of questions have come from the microbiology portion. And these all, they have a correlation, like some of them, they have a correlation with the clinical stuff also. So we are discussing all of them here, one by one, in detail. And why we are doing that? Because I'm pretty sure that these things will be repeated in AIIMS also and in the All India NEET exam also. So guys, do remember and do read in and around these topics. They will definitely, you will find them there in the NEET or AIIMS exam. So first of all, we'll take up this particular question. The primary lung abscess is caused by all except. So Bactrois does it, microaerophilic streptococci does it, peptostreptococcus does it, pneumococcus does not do the primary lung abscess. Okay. Now there is a table in the Harrison. And if you focus upon that particular table, you will able to answer up most of the questions regarding the lung abscess and all. And there are a lot of tables in the Harrison, and directly the question is being picked from there. Okay, so in this particular series, I will try to discuss up those tables with you, and try to make you learn some of them. Okay, so let's come to that particular table only first. So in this particular table, we'll go like line wise. The first one, that is the primary lung abscess, if this was a question actually, and if this is a clinical condition, as you can see down what is being written, usually with the risk factors for aspiration. Okay, because of this particular risk factor of aspiration, this primary lung abscess is being formed. Okay, now if somebody asks you that what are these risk factors for aspiration, so remember guys, I will write here that these are altered mental status. Okay, there might be an altered mental status. Okay, then like alcoholism, if somebody have done binge drinking and all at a party, having the drug overdose also, they are the sufferers of it. Okay, they will get this particular thing. Then any particular cerebrovascular or cardiovascular event. Okay, cerebrovascular, cardiovascular events, they are also there. Okay, NMD, that is neuromuscular disease, they also associate with the same. And even some esophageal dysmotilities, they also are responsible for the same. Okay, now we already know that if a person is lying up in the recumbent position, this particular position, for a very long time on the bed, then it's a very high risk stuff for the aspiration. Okay, so long, if a person is lying off in this particular recumbent position, that fellow is at a risk of aspiration, no doubt about that. Other than that, one more thing, that why we say that you should have a good dental hygiene and all. If a person is having this microaerophilic strepto in the gingiva stuff, okay, and a person is a case of a gingivitis or having a periodontal abscess and all, okay, so these particular fellows, along with these all things which I have just told you, if it is happening like that, then it's an ideal platform to produce what? Primary lung abscess. Okay, so this aspiration is the main risk factor. And what are the various pathogens involved? So guys, another question, the pathogens involved are anaerobes. Mainly they are anaerobes. Peptostreptococcus is one of the anaerobe. Privateola is also one of the anaerobe. And bacteroids, they are the important three ones. And then a less known fellow, that is Streptococcus miliari and the microaerophilic strepto. These are the ones which are responsible for this primary lung abscess. Now, this peptostreptococcus, if you remember up, it's a gram-positive non-sporing anaerobe. Okay, this is gram-positive non-sporing anaerobe, and it's a cocci, as it's written up in the name only. So it's a gram positive non-sporing. Okay, so if I write up non-sporing, it's a non-sporing anaerobe, Peptostreptococcus, and it was asked in the PGI exam. Then Prevotella. Prevotella, if you remember up, I have told you in the bacterial vaginosis. Okay, in the bacterial vaginosis, you know Gardnerella vaginalis is the main one, but Prevotella is also there. Mobiluncus is also there. So all these two fellows, Mobiluncus and these particular ones, Mobiluncus is not there actually. So we'll focus upon the Prevotella. Prevotella is what? Is a gram negative bacilli. Okay, this is gram positive. This one is gram negative bacilli, and this is also non-sporing anaerobe. Okay, non-sporing anaerobe. Another question which is being asked in the PGI exam. Then they have asked regarding the bacteroids also, and the bacteroids are also what? It's a gram negative bacilli. It's a gram negative bacillus, which is also a non-sporing anaerobe. So this particular question was asked, and it was given like this. All the following are these non-sporing anaerobes except and all. So if these types of questions you want to do, then this thing also be known. So basically what I want to say that the primary lung abscess is mainly done by the anaerobes, and in that also which fellows? Peptostreptococcus, Prevotella and bacteroids. Along with that, microaerophilic streptococci, this name you need to remember. This is regarding the primary lung abscess. Now, the secondary lung abscess, if we talk about the secondary lung abscess, always there will be a condition. Underlying immunocompromised condition will be there, or some obstruction will be there. Okay, either this will there or some obstruction will be there, and then this particular abscess will be formed up. Now, what are the fellows which can do it? Obviously, the Staph aureus, this can do. Pseudomonas aeruginosa is an important entity to be remembered for the secondary lung abscess. Other Enterobacteriaceae members, fine. You know Enterobacteriaceae, those particular fellows, Klebsiella and all that. Okay, Nocardia. Okay, Aspergillus, Mucorales, these are the fungus which are involved up here. Cryptococcus have also come. Okay, so AMC. Then another fellows which are less ones, Legionella. This also can lead to the secondary lung abscess. And Pneumocystis zerosi. This also can lead to the secondary lung abscess formation. But always what will be present? A immunocompromised state, along with some obstruction, that is bronchial obstruction, it can happen. And this can happen because of what? This obstruction, bronchial obstruction, it is because of some malignancy or some foreign body and all. So basically because of some obstruction, and obstruction can be by what? By malignancy or foreign body and all. Now coming to the third point here, the third point you can see up is embolic lesions. Because of septic emboli, this particular embolic lesions, these are the, this can also lead to the formation of lung abscess. And which fellows does it? One is Staph aureus. And obviously, you know that right-sided valve endocarditis, the most common cause is this fellow only, that is the Staph aureus, that is tricuspid one, that is involved. Okay, from there the septic emboli can come and it can cause the abscess. Another one, you can remember this particular name, that is Lemierre syndrome. Okay, and which organism is involved? Fusobacterium necrophorum. And what is Fusobacterium? Again guys, it's a gram negative bacilli non-sporing anaerobe. So this gram negative bacilli non-sporing anaerobe, I have discussed up in a mnemonic also for that, because non-sporing anaerobe was a asked question of PGI and can come again. Okay, so guys, if somebody asks you here, I'm telling you that if you want to remember those fellows, you can remember this mnemonic, BPL fuse. And BPL fuse is what? B is bacteroids, P is Prevotella, L is Leptotrichia, and F is Fusobacteria. Just now we have talked about. And what I'm talking about? I'm talking about gram negative non-sporing anaerobes. And this was asked guys in the PGI exam. So need to remember that. Okay. And if somebody ask you regarding the gram positive fellows, gram positive non-sporing anaerobes, in them you can remember of certain names we just heard of also famous ones Lactobacillus. Okay, Lactobacillus, mobile uncus, we talked about a mobile uncus. So all these are like, I will not be going deep into that. Gram positive nonsporic anaerobes, you remember the names like this particular one. One of the names is mobile uncus, and mobile uncus was also doing what, guys? It was doing the bacterial vaginosis. It was doing the bacterial vaginosis along with Provotella, but this is gram positive one. Like your famous one, that is Lactobacillus. This is also termed as gram positive non-sporing anaerobes. For this also, I have made a mnemonic and discussed up in the YouTube channel only. So you, I will give that link also, and you can remember that particular mnemonic for these fellows, that is gram positive non-sporing anaerobes. Okay, so now coming back, this name you can remember of this might, it is sounding to me, it can come as a question, that is Limmer syndromes, and the involved bacteria is which one? That is a Fusobacterium necrophorum. Okay guys, now the fourth one, that which are the endemic ones, which are like localized to a particular area, that can happen with or without underlying immunocompromise, fine. And the main one happens to be MTB. And AVM also involved up in Kansasi. So MAC, you know, Kansasi, all you know, these fellows are what? These fellows are, they're in the atypical mycobacteria, if you remember up. So along with TB, these fellows are there, which can cause this endemic infections, and that can lead to this formation lung abscess and all. Then you have those particular fellows like coccidioides. These are the fungus, dimorphic ones. Histoplasma, another one. Blastomyces, another one. So these three important ones, they are dimorphic fungus, and then there's some certain parasites like Entamoeba histolytica, okay, Paragonimus westermanni, and Strongyloides stercoralis. So Entamoeba histolytica, protozoa, that can also lead to lung abscess, guys, remember that. Okay, so by chance if you get one of the options of it, then you can think of that this can also lead to lung abscess, and you know, no, extraintestinal amebiasis, so like that. Fine, so it goes to lungs also, mostly liver, but it can go to lungs. Paragonimus westermanni, another name for lung fluke. Okay, and lung fluke is what? It's a trematode, so obviously it can go to the lungs and cause abscess and all. Fine. Strongyloides stercoralis, this particular fellow is a nematode, and if you remember up that in its life cycle, it goes to the lungs, and when it goes to the lungs, it can cause the lung abscess and all. Okay guys, so these are the names for the endemic ones. So basically what you have observed here, Mycobacterium tuberculosis along with atypical mycobacteria, then you have these three fungus, and then you have this particular fellows. One is protozoa, another one is lung fluke, and another one is a nematode that is termed as Strongyloides stercoralis. Okay guys, now the fifth one is miscellaneous conditions, and miscellaneous conditions is what? That is the bacterial pathogen, often Staph aureus again, and after the influenza. So this question can also come, that post influenza which particular infection can happen and can lead to abscess and all. The answer is Staph aureus as per Harrison. Some books they write Strepto also, but you better go with Harrison, and answer is Staph aureus. And actinomyces, you know that actinomyces, those fellows, number of them are there, actinomyces israeli and all that stuff. So obviously Israeli does PID and all, but some species of actinomyces are there, lofi and all, they can lead to this lung abscess and all. Fine. So in total, this particular table is a mine for the questions. Okay, and in what sorts it can come, I have already told you that which all questions can come regarding them. Primary lung abscess, remember two things important. First thing is aspiration. This is a question. Okay, because of all those conditions which I have discussed up, anaerobes are responsible, and gram positive non-sporing, they don't spore, important. Okay, then secondary lung abscess mostly happens because of underlying immunocompromise or obstruction, second point. Okay, in that Pseudomonas, Staph aureus, these two need to be remembered. Embolic phenomena, Staph aureus from the endocarditis, obviously right-sided valve. Fusobacterium necrophorum, that is Limmer syndrome, that name you need to remember. Okay, endemic infections, these all TB, atypical mycobacteria. Okay, then you have these particular fellows, that is the fungus, dimorphic fungus, coccidioides, histoplasma, and blasto, and parasites which can go to the lungs. Entamoeba histolytica even can do this, Paragonal vestibule, lung flu and strongylus sacralis. It in the life cycle it goes to the lungs for maturation. Miscellaneous conditions, again the bacterial pathogens, staph aureus after the influenza infection, mostly A. Okay, that is influenza A. Belonging to which family? Influenza, that is orthomyxoviridae. And another viral infection, that is the other viral infections also post then. Staph aureus mostly does the lung abscess and all. Actinomyces, you know that actinomyces, this can also leads to this particular one. Even though it's anaerobe, it can lead to this particular lung abscess and all. Now you can say, sir, how they will produce lung abscess, they are anaerobes. So guys, for that answer is, they are not strict anaerobes. They can survive there, okay? And that's why whenever you go for culture of these primary lung abscess and all, and you will always find a polymicrobial flora, okay? You will never find that the bacteroids will come and all that. So that's why they say that as such, it's of no use to go for these particular culture and all as such, okay? Some fellows, they do go to find out that which particular organism is responsible and all that. But in total, it is not advisable, because mostly the things are what? Polymicrobial flora, okay? So this will come up, and this you already know as such, and this can be easily diagnosed up with this particular thing. So there will be a putrid smell coming up, okay? And obviously this smell is coming of what? The sputum. Putrid smell of the sputum. This itself is indicating that this is a anaerobes which are responsible for this abscess and all. So these are the clinical points which saves your time, and you don't waste your time on cultures and all sometime. Okay, so here I suppose in the primary lung abscess and all, culture does not have much of a role, because mostly it will be coming polymicrobial, and that's why you focus upon the clinical features and all, and these will tell you regarding the various particular manifestations, and they will tell you that yes, this is a scenario of these anaerobic lung abscess. Okay, and if somebody asks you that what might be the clinical features which you can look out here for a lung abscess and all, so guys, for that you remember up this particular thing, that obviously there will be high grade fever because of the abscess and all. Okay, there will be cough, it can be a productive one, so sputum production can be there, fine. And sometimes it can have the chest pain also. It can have a chest pain also. So these are the conditions mostly associating with acute ones. So that lung abscess which are readily formed. So that is the fresh cases. They present with what? Fever, cough, sputum production and chest pain. And those which are chronic ones. So they present up with certain features like night sweats, fatigue, they are observed up with them. Okay, now if somebody asks you that how you'll diagnose and all these particular things, so again in the Harrison there is a picture here, and this particular picture is showing up, it's a CT scan of the chest, and this particular CT scan is showing up a lymphoma patient, okay, who developed a what? Severe Pseudomonas aeruginosa pneumonia. Okay, that fellow developed what? Severe Pseudomonas aeruginosa pneumonia, and that particular is being represented by this particular arrow. Okay, you can see that left lung infiltrate with a concern for the central regions of the necrosis, this particular one. Okay, so that is there. And 2 weeks later, there is a area of cavitation with air fluid levels. And this can be, you can observe this particular thing by this white arrow. Okay. So basically, 2 weeks later, there is a areas of cavitation here with air fluid levels visible in this region. And what is the meaning of this thing? That the abscess is being formed here later on. Okay. Before, it was because of Pseudomonas aeruginosa pneumonia have happened up, and later on it have changed into what? Abscess formation after 2 weeks. Okay, and why it have happened up? I've just now told you that secondary lung abscess is because of some immunocompromised conditions or some obstruction. So here is the immunocompromised condition, lymphoma, Because of that, this particular thing starts, and later on with the pneumonia like features, and later on this particular air fluid levels or abscess that is being observed up in this particular one. Okay, so this is a typical feature. So obviously you get my point in this, that the best to go for is what? CT scan. Okay, CT scan is the best, and with the help of the CT scan only, if you want to like remove it also, you want to like make a diagnosis, or you want to like remove it also, then CT guided you can do that. Okay, that will be the best to do. Okay, in fact it should be done like that only. Now coming to the treatment part, guys. Okay, coming to the treatment part. So if it's a, like if we talk about the primary lung abscess and all, okay, and we are not going for culture and all, so it's a polymicrobial stuff, and we are saying that they are mostly anaerobes. So what we should prefer? So we should prefer metronidazole, yes or no? But the problem is metronidazole, like it takes care of the anaerobes and all, but it does not take care of the microaerophilic strepto. Okay, and this microaerophilic strepto is in plenty, and this will be saved off. So we need a drug which covers this fellow also, and that's why you prefer this particular drug, that is the clindamycin. So clindamycin is preferred over metronidazole or over penicillin in the various trials. It is being found to be effective than all of them. Okay, so clinda 600 milligram, it is being said IV 3 times daily. Okay, 3 times daily you have to give the clinda. You have to start off with this. Okay, and when the fever and the clinical features, they go off, okay, which I've just discussed up, then you can switch it to the 300 milligram oral. Okay, and this is 4 times a day QID, 4 times a day. Okay guys, so this you need to remember. Obviously you can use another things also, like those fluoroquinolones which have affinity towards the lungs and all, that is moxifloxacin is one of them that can also be used, moxifloxacin and all. But metronidazole like is not effective as a single agent, remember that. So if they ask Karna that which drug does not prove so much effective here, the answer is metronidazole. Okay, and this is basically regarding what? Primary lung abscess, because it is polymicrobial and all. And in the secondary one, I have already told you that that is because of some obstruction, bronchial obstruction, that is due to malignancy or foreign body. So basically in them you can go for culture, and according to the culture you can decide upon then which particular drug you will give. Like for Pseudomonas, you can give a piperacillin tazobactam combination, that is the best. Okay, and with the Staph aureus and all, you can prefer up as per the sensitivity pattern of them. Okay, so these are things. And if somebody asks you that if the abscess becomes like more in diameter, that is more than 6 to 8 centimeter in diameter, if this is the like problem that it have become large, then you need to go for the surgery. Then you need to go for the surgery, or you can go for what? Percutaneous drainage of the abscess, because this will not go by the antibiotics and all. So basically what you have to go for, percutaneous drainage of the abscess, you need to go for that. Okay, percutaneous drainage of the abscess and all. And this is being preferred in those mostly that those who you see that they are poor surgical candidates, you should not go for surgery in them. Okay, but definitely one thing is for sure, that this much diameter of abscess will not respond to the antibiotics and all. So that you need to remember. Okay, and these all things are very easy to say, that we'll go for percutaneous drainage, we go for surgery and all that, but the patient should be like ready for its complications also. And complications can mount from where to what. Pneumothorax can happen, guys. Hemothorax can happen. Okay, and obviously if you are not doing it with the proper precautions and all, you are inducing of the bacteria from the outer, from the skin and all that into the space. So all these are there, guys, which you need to remember here. And if somebody asks you that mortality rates of one, primary abscess mortality rate is very less, is around 2%. But yes, in the secondary one, the rates can mount to 75% also. Okay, so I suppose I made myself clear, but this table is very important. And these particular regarding the treatment stuff, I also told you how they will present up with that and what are the conditions which leads to this primary lung abscess and all. You know that altered mental status and all that stuff. Okay, so basically this is the way to approach of the lung abscess and all. I have shown you the picture also, CT scan, in which like Pseudomonas infection happened and pneumonia, later on the abscess formation and all. Thank you so much.